We're live. Yes, Colin, sorry. It's this is the way it works. 9:10, 9:12, we announce 9 o'clock. Steve, you have technical difficulties. We're here, we're live. You guys are very impatient in the comments. Stevie B, Vinny T here, and once we're ready, Steve, we're just going to get everybody coming on, the Facebook folks, the Twitter folks. Did you see the big news, Steve? Big news.
Nope.
Roman Reigns is a Paul Heyman guy.
I have no idea what that means.
Paul Heyman, Brock Lesnar, now Roman Reigns is with him. I'll catch you up after the podcast. All right, we're ready. So, Stevie P, if you allow me, let's get it started in the right way. Yes, we are. But I think I like it. Cari Amici Sport TV, welcome yet to another edition of the Milan Weekly Podcast. Here we talk everything Milan, and even with a big week of Milan, even with no soccer, we're still here. And well, we're not professionals.
Nor do we pretend to be.
And you're very welcome, Bashwale, Vinny T, Stevie P, always faithful. You're here Monday. Nine-ish, Steve, nine-ish, this is the way we roll.
Well, this is what it has to be.
That's the way it's got to be. Quite the week. And I know we got plenty of questions, whether it be from Patreon, from Twitter. I know some of them started yesterday. And Steve, I needed to text you this weekend for, you know, you are the Mercato Madness King, that you love this kind of stuff. And what a turn of events. We're going to get into it, right? Anything you want to talk about, any feelings you want to share before getting into the news of the week for our beloved Milan.
This is what it is, guys. You either love it or you hate it. It's Mercato Madness, and it's something that Italy and European soccer does very well. It drives people crazy. For me, guys, I laugh at it, and it's amazing to see these types of transfers. That, you know, this type of transfer here, where it actually favors the team that you love. You know, you look at your phone, you smile, you feel like tweeting. You feel like shooting out a couple of tweets to people who got burned. But you kind of lay back and you let it simmer. To, you know, especially Milan, got to see him sitting down signing those papers before anything. So,
and that's why we love coming on here. This is our therapy, Steve's therapy, talking about Milan. So before going straight into the questions, quite the week, Steve. We had the official signing of Ibrahimovic today, ufficiale. And I think we keep on repeating that we don't believe shit until we actually see it, like we saw it today. Tonali, siamo alle dettagli, supposedly it's a done thing. I know none of us wants to jinx it, but it looks like it's a done deal. Another thing that I wanted to read out, because, you know, they announced the Europa League matchup on the 17th of September. And it was pretty cool because Colin wrote to me on Facebook. And a little history from the Shamrock Rovers. And Colin, forgive me if I'm going to be pronouncing these words not correctly, but he's like, the news that Milan will be playing Shamrock Rovers here is great for our club. First time since 1975 when they played Athlone Town. Stadium is literally 5 minutes from my house, too. So we'll try to have some sort of meeting with the squad, but the COVID restrictions are hard to get around. If we lose, myself and Mike will be going into exile in Milan. I can work remotely, so it's possible. Tonali news is a significant sign that we mean business, and I have this in a positive start. Forza, un braccio, forza mia. That's pretty cool for him to be, like, basically right there, close to playing Shamrock Rovers, and we better not lose because it is una gemma secca. And 17th of September, Steve, if I'm not mistaken, we're going to be our first match. Are you a bit, before we get into the big news, how do you feel about this Europa League? Do you think we should shoot for it or really concentrate on Serie A?
They need to move forward in Europa League. They're signing players to create depth on Milan. We need these other games, especially, you know, in Europa League, get some of these guys some European football. We're going to talk about Tonali. You know, it hasn't played European football. It's important. It's important that they go for it. And it's, again, until the Serie A starts and they can concentrate on the Scudetto race, or not Scudetto race, but, you know, their main goal of at least one of the top four spots to get back into Champions League. And you know what? With everything that's going on and everybody is upside down, a couple of lucky results and we'll be in the mix, right? And I hope it continues this way, because I think they're doing some great stuff for Milan, and now and in the future. So
exactly.
And plus, for Milan Club Dublin, what happens if Milan loses? They're gonna have nowhere to run. Colin, Mike, they're gonna end up getting on a plane. They're gonna have to come here to Montreal. They're gonna have to quarantine. We're gonna have to shack them up. It's gonna cost us some money for beer. And I don't think they want to come over here because it's pretty cold in the winter.
There we go. But we would greet them with open arms, both of them. I'll take care of the drinking part with them. Steve, we are going to get into these Tonali questions, but tell me, how did this make you feel? You know, I put the title that we stick it to Inter one more time. I know, you know, Francis had a couple of comments. We're going to talk about what he wrote on Twitter after, but forget Steve the podcaster, and you know, how did Steve Polillo himself feel when he was like, what, they're moving away from Tonali and he's coming to us, a known fan of Milan? So talk to me about your feelings when you were like, okay, this seems to be like 95% done.
Oh, we had spoken about it when the rumor started of Tonali to Inter, and I was very open with it. I didn't think it was a good move for him, for his career. Selfishly, I wanted Milan because I find that I like the player. I'll go into my exact comments after, because I know there's questions coming in there. But I felt good. I felt that, you know, Maldini and Massara, there wasn't a lot of jibber-jabber about this transfer. They were somewhat in, somewhat out. But, you know, hearing Cellino's remarks about he appreciated the seriousness of Maldini. Mm-hmm. Guys, it seems like, you know, he's coming into his own as the role that we've given him, and we all want him to succeed in at Milan. So I was very happy to see that. And, you know, again, with Inter, I don't know what's going on with Inter. You know, I'm surprised Conte's still there. After the crybaby fiasco that he had after the Europa League,
mala di pancia, Steve. He had a heart. He had you know, an indigestion.
Yeah, not even indigestion. He was a baby. He actually cried. It's I don't know where he's going. I get that, you know, Inter's window is somewhat now, but look, again, the type of players that he wants to bring in. Yeah, that's fine. The Vidal to create a little bit of depth, and you know, he wants Kante from Chelsea, but you know, when you're up on that $55 million mark, guys, that's a lot of money for a 29-year-old, right?
So exactly. So we appreciate it, and hopefully it turns out to be you know, fantastic, so they could it could burn them even more in the future. Taking it over to Patreon first, Peter saying, you know, Tonali of course will be the topic of the evening. Questions is like, you know, will he rotate with Bennacer? Will he get more time in Coppa versus Serie A? How excited should we be that Maldini was able to pull it off? So you know, the whole rotation thing, Steve. Do you? Look, I'm not going to pretend that I followed Sandro Tonali from day one, and I know exactly what kind of, you know, player he is and this and that, but I don't think he's starting on this team. What do you think? Do you think he's, unless you got to change formation? Because if we need to believe all of these rumors that, you know, Bakayoko, even siamo alle dettagli, I know it's two different players, but Bakayoko would have to accept some sort of bench role, and Tonali, do you see him more starting the Serie A? The Serie A, more Europa League. How do you think he's going to put him in there, Pioli?
This is why I love this platform. Is I don't want to go on Twitter and talk about this shit. I don't want to go on any social media site besides YouTube and Milan Weekly Podcast. Guys, again, we're going to repeat for probably the 30th time. And please spread this to your Milan Twitter. We did not buy the next Pirlo. We bought Sandro Tonali. You know, everybody was coming out with, you know, the Pirlo comments and the Totti comments, greatest in the world, more complete than Pirlo. Guys, these are all flowers. These are all flowers that, you know, Pirlo and Totti, you know, they throw around. Guys, it takes a lot of work to become more complete than Pirlo. It takes a lot of work to become the best midfielder in the world. Potential. If you think, potential or no potential.
A lot of people talk about potential, right? But you
can have potential, but it's all crap if you're not going to willing to put in the work. You know, we fall in love that he is a Milan fan at 11 years old, and you know, and now he's playing. I mean, it's a nice story. It's a good impact. It's a good transfer all around for Milan because of what Maldini did, taking him away from Inter and bringing him to Milan. But guys, this guy's gonna have to put in the work. Right now, you know, Milan finished ahead of Brescia by miles. Brescia was a terrible team. Hmm. He's an automatic starter at Brescia. He's playing in national team football now. Doesn't see the pitch quite often. When he does, he has a work rate. You know, talking with Francis and, you know, the snake and trying to bring people down, it's not that I want to be negative. It's you got to manage your expectations with these guys.
We got to be realistic, Steve. We got to be realistic.
He's a talent. A lot of people wanted him, and, you know, Milan got him, but give him time to develop. If you don't give him time to develop, everybody's going to be disappointed.
You know what I was thinking about, Steve? You know, we talk about the importance of Ibra, correct? I want you to think, if Tonali was coming into this team 2 years ago, right, on a high horse, I don't know the guy, I don't know his personality, but do you not think Ibra being there pushes even more to come in as a humble person, right? Work hard, because that 38 years old over there is working harder than you, and you need to earn your spot from over there. Do you think that, like, even from that presence of being on the team? I know you got Maldini there in the stands, whatever the case may be.
This is more than Ibra, guys. This is generational. They were talking about Sandro Tonali even before Ibra came back. Whatever he can give in terms of experience is fine. But guys, this guy needs to develop. He needs to play. He needs to, you know, if he comes into camp and he puts in the work rate and he starts, it means, you know, Pioli is paid for that. Pick the best team. Get your best 11 players on the field. It might be match day one. It might be, you know, we waited for Bennacer. Waited for it. It wasn't the same hype, but we waited. There's going to be a lot of hype. This guy has qualities of, you know, talking with Francis, he brought up a good Milan comparison. If he becomes a sort of Albertini-type player, will people be disappointed? Absolutely fucking not. But it's because he has the same hair as Pirlo. You know, people were saying on Twitter, Milan is the best, the top five midfielder in the world, a top five midfielder in the world. Hey, guys, you got to tone it down a bit, man. You got to tone it down a bit and be realistic. It's not that I want to be negative. I'm happy for the transfer. But make this team grow. We're missing still a lot of pieces. I saw here in the comments, Milan da Scudetto. Ma bella Madonna. What have you guys been watching for the past 11 years? Milan da Scudetto. But guys, you can't even talk that way. If it's a miracle like Leicester, if it's a miracle like that, then yes. And you know what? A lot of things have to go wrong for those top four teams. We still have to prove that we can get to the top four. And we have not done so in the past 2 years.
Exactly. The belief is there. We've made the proper moves. Maybe some more moves coming in. Diaz, they're talking about this and that. Guys, it's a step in the right way. But we don't want to come out here and start talking about we won the Scudetto already. We're going to win the Europa League. Guys, once again, it's happened in the past. Not just for Milan. Guys coming in from Serie B, Serie C teams. And they come into a big team. It can't handle the pressure. And, you know, completely flop. So it's not a thing. What you think we wish? No, we're not wishing this upon us. We want to win, right? But hold on the excitement. We're gonna get there, right? Just like the way people are saying Messi is already Manchester City. Me, I'm putting my money. Messi's not going anywhere. But that's another story for another day. But guys, we are very happy. We're gonna get there. But let's give it time. Give it time.
Yeah, what people have to realize is that when Sandro Tonali was 11, watching Milan win the Scudetto the last time, Ibrahimovic was on that team. He comes 30, 35 million, whatever we're going to pay for him. I don't know. There's 10,000 different formulas that we have to follow. So I'm not going to tell you I know the exact amount. But guys, we're 11 years later and Ibra is still leading the line. That's a serious problem. And there's nothing against Ibra. Ibra's a fantastic athlete. He's a fantastic professional. He's a phenom. But Ibra still leading this Milan after 11 years is a serious problem.
But Pasquale says it correctly. First time in a long time we have hope. We always have like that kind of hope at the beginning, but it's more.
Nah. Come on, Pasquale. I'm not gonna. You're gonna sit there and you're gonna say this is the only time you had hope. You're lying. You're lying. You are part of it. It's not a. You didn't say different kind of hope. He said yes, the first said time.
Kind of hope. Yeah.
First time said, in a long time we have hope. It's not a different type of hope. It's the same hope. It's the same hope.
No.
Don't lie to yourself.
Hope of last year is the same hope as this year?
Fucking right. Don't sit there and lie. We had Gianpaolo and we thought that we were going to reinvent the wheel. We thought we had the next Sacchi.
Okay, and the year before then?
And the year before, it's always that. You love the team. You have that hope. Everybody starts at zero. Don't tell me you have different hope this year than you had last year than you had the year before.
To me, I did. But anyways, I like this story against Benetton.
Absolutely not. If you're saying that, you're lying to everybody.
Derek says, will Milan change formation to allow for the best players to be on the field at all times? Rotating Tonali or Benacer seems counterproductive. Do they have to start looking at a different formation, Steve? Even though we've been using the
Not right now. You have to build on the momentum. There's another question that's coming up. That's why I'm going to get into it a little bit. Guys, we have to build on what we did in the past 6 months. And it has to build from there. It has to organically grow into something positive. Counterproductive? Fuck no. I don't think so. Why is it counterproductive? Baggio rode the bench. He rode the bench for Del Piero.
Yeah, that's a point. But you know, you don't think like maybe a 4-3-3 to have it like as a plan B?
Why?
Because if you're going to bring in all these guys, Steve, you got to make them play somehow, no?
Play Coppa Italia. Play in the league. There's going to be yellow cards. Benacer picks up yellow cards people pick up Big Macs at McDonald's. He's going to get time to play. You have to earn your stripes. Just because he
sells this the way people pick up Big Macs at McDonald's.
All kinds. Drive in the drive-thru, next Big Mac. Guys, Sandro Tonali has to come in this team and he has to earn a starting spot. How could be rotating counterproductive? That's what I want to know.
Because if you're going to do always with two midfielders, right? Kessie is not going anywhere. Kessie's staying there, correct? You're going to rotate Bakayoko with him. Then you're going to have Tonali. You're going to have Benacer. This guy Diaz. No, Diaz is a striker, I believe.
Okay, when we lost everybody to injury, who were we putting in there? Krunic? Wouldn't you rather put Tonali in there?
But you don't think having a second type of formation is a good plan B?
It's a good in the game. You don't know what's going to happen in the game. When are you going to use this plan B? Look at Conte. He doesn't even have a plan B. He doesn't even know what B is. There's plan A and then build all kinds of players. Tonali needs to come into this team and needs to find his role. What that role is going to be. We don't know what that role is going to be. Why are we going to start changing formations? We didn't even take the pitch yet.
All right. I'm just saying, like, it's good to have a plan B, but if you're saying...
Of course, you have to have a plan B, but it's an in-game adjustment. It's not a plan B for the first couple of games.
I guess we'll see who else comes in the signings, because if we have to believe everything we read, we're getting all kinds of new players. And anyways, we'll see. We have, the Mercato finishes one. Guys, in the comments, if you could help me out. Is it until at the beginning of the season, right? I think that put that rule on the last year. Anyways, let me know, guys, if you have a chance in the comments. Youssef saying, listening to the players and Pioli's interview makes me worried because all they talk about is the past, how great they were post-COVID, and I'm afraid of overconfidence. What do you think? Maybe in the past, we used to live in the past a lot, but I think they need to continue talking like this and be on that momentum and believe in themselves and not have these little...
It's the first time in 11 years we have some sort of confidence. We just finished saying it. We hope every single year. Now, for once, in the first 11 years, we have some sort of confidence, and it's a bad thing.
There we go. So, no, but he was like, I get it from over there, but, you know, continue writing, because I cannot have these little teams come to our house and keep on believing that they could beat Milan. We need to get back into exactly the way we were thinking, the way we were playing, and the way we stuck it to a team like Juventus going down to nil and scoring four. Keep on believing. Ticho says, with the excitement of Tonali comes the fear of a flop. There's always a really fine line between him growing successfully and having a disastrous year or more. What, in your opinion, is the key to helping Tonali hit the next level and becoming an important player, not only for Milan, but for Italian soccer? And now, Ciccio's probably going to say, Voci del Canada, he likes to say that we're like a breaking news kind of thing. So, what is the key to helping Tonali?
That he comes here, and people squash, automatically, he squashed it too. Once you start comparing him to Pirlo, it has to be squashed. And he's done it. He said it himself. I have similar characteristics, but my idol is Gattuso. Those are two completely different players. Now, he's smart enough. And you know, in reading that, I said, you know what? I like this type of attitude. He wants to be Sandro Tonali. He does not want to be in the shadow of Pirlo. I tweeted it. Let this kid grow. That's how you develop talent. That's how he finds his own role. I love people that, you know, we post the Brescia highlights. Brescia was a terrible team. I'm not putting it all on him. But guys, Sandro Tonali against certain opponents, guys, this year, and I watched. I was interested. Guys, he was invisible. And now, it's a byproduct of the team that he's playing with. But guys, we're not Milan of 1992 over here, guys. This is a Milan that is in crescita. So it's a good time for him to join.
By the way, Steve, I don't know if you noticed Presidentes in the chats. And have you noticed live viewers? It's the first time we're over 45. We're almost at 50. You see what Presidente does for the live viewing.
Presidente doesn't know nothing. He got lucky. He was able to put the kids to bed and he logged on.
Ian is asking us, do you think Berlusconi and Uncle Fester will secretly be cheering for Milan when Monza plays them in the upcoming friendly? With all their signings, Monza might be playing Milan in Serie A next year. I don't think they'll be cheering on for Milan, but I don't think they're going to be booing them either. It should be nice.
Vince's internet is really crap, guys. I'm going to tell you.
Hello? No, I guess I think it's mine. I think it's yours. Can you guys see us on the YouTube? No, I'm good now. Sorry, I upgraded the internet. It sucks a shit. But yeah, Steve, what do you think? Would it be nice to see Silvio and Uncle Fester at the San Siro cheering on Monza? So it would be nice to see.
No, it's gonna be nice. It's gonna be a little bit weird to see them cheering another team. It's a friendly, so I'm curious to see what they do with Monza. But again, this is the realization, guys, that this is not Silvio and Galliani's Milan anymore. This has passed on. This is. I hope everybody understands this now, and gets it for once and for all, guys. This is what it is. It's l'aria di Silvio Berlusconi and Galliani is finished.
To Twitter we go. Thank you to our Patreons. Thank you to all 26 subscribers. And Steve, you're the one that froze, not me. So maybe it's your internet, the one that I sold you. No, it's definitely mine. Eggs and pancakes. I know a couple of these questions are going to be repetitive, guys. We're going to try to go through them because we do appreciate you guys reaching out to us. Let's say we sign Tonali, Brahim, Bakayoko, and Aurier. Could you safely say we can challenge for top four? What's the goal?
Who's Aurier?
Huh?
Who's
Serge Aurier?
Aurier. Are we going to stop with these rumors? Right backs at $30 million are problems. I don't want to hear that anymore. I don't want to hear Tottenham. Just to talk about Aurier. Tottenham's Tottenham, imagine Tottenham have a Netflix documentary talking to at first day of school, talking with the parents. We're going to shout out Mike Richards, the only Tottenham fan I know in the world, besides Francis Colagiacomo, who's it's a second favorite team. Okay. Tottenham has their own Netflix. Imagine Tottenham. They haven't won anything since like 1899 Tottenham. And Jose Mourinho talking straight up about Aurier, saying that he is a walking penalty.
All right. So, but, you know, we were talking about that eggs and pancake that until, you know, can we challenge for top four? You know, we'll see. We'll see how the first, you know, maybe 10 games goes. But in the end, like Steve was saying, you need those other top three, four to go on some sort of slump or to make mistakes because, you know, guys, let's face it. Juventus ain't gonna lose 20 games this season. They might, you know, they might not be as powerful as they were last year, but it's still Juventus. Inter is not going to, you know, we like them when they lose, but you know, Inter's gonna be there. Napoli's gonna be there. I don't know about Roma. I don't know about Lazio, but still, you know, we'll see. Steve and I always go after 10 games. We kind of give our first impressions, and then we always say at half season, right?
Imagine we're talking about this and we forgot to mention the most important thing. Could it be, and this is a miracle because I don't remember ever this happening before, that we're actually going to have a squad pretty much like, you know, re-signing Ibrahimovic. Tonali seems like it's going to be done pretty early. Bakayoko and Diaz, we're going to see how it is. But maybe, guys, by the middle of September, we're going to pretty much know what our team looks like before the start of the season. That's huge, guys. That's stuff that, you know, I'm going to tip my hat to Maldini. I'm going to tip my hat to I don't speak a word Masara. And guys, this is something that we've always been scrapping at the end of mercatos to pick up loans and options and all bunch of funky formulas. If he gets his stuff right, you know, then at the end of the mercato, he can pick and choose if he wants to reinforce or not. But the key signings are there. And look, we don't have un tesoretto. We don't have the bank account of unlimited funds here.
What a segue, Steve, into the next question, because a Milanista NYC says, with Milan's performance the last 12 games of the season, confirmation of Ibra, Tonali, and all the weight of Maldini carries, does that get Milan one big signing before Mercato closes that no one will expect? I can believe it now, the way Maldini's been reacting. I'm not saying it's going to happen because I don't know if we have the money, but it's been a while. Eh? That one surprise signing, remember, was Robinho out of nowhere after Ibrahimovic. But it seems that he's getting better into his role, and he does carry some weight.
Yeah, and it's well put because, you know, the Tonali will cost us $10 million, this transfer. Bakayoko will pay for the loan and will have an option, apparently. And Diaz, it's either a straight option or we pay for the loan and we have the option to buy. So that's the fighting for – and, you know – Milanista non evoluti always says braccio di ferro tra Real Madrid e Milan. So we'll see what that does. In reality, this year we might not even have spent a lot of money. So can we believe in that track? Yeah, we can believe. Will Elliot release the funds? I don't know. And who is that going to be? Where are you going to pick now? What are you going to do? You're going to go get that center back, that partner for Romagnoli. You're going to go find that right back who's not named Aurier for Milan. Look, it's up in the air. And we have to remember, too, that he has to concentrate as well on, you know, we can't keep all these players. Players are going to need to leave.
Just let it not be a Juventino or a Lapanucci. We don't need those kind of surprise
signings. No.
Gigi Lapatat, what do you think of what Zlatan said about Hakan and the history of the number 10 in his interview today? I actually did not read up on that. I don't know if you took a look there, Steve. I know he chose 11. He says that number 21, he didn't feel himself. But do you know what Gigi Lapatat is referring to?
I have no idea.
Gigi, if you want to maybe write it in the comments, I'll get back to it from over there. You know, we're not professionals. We're not, you know, we just read the articles as much as you guys. We're just two regular Joes.
I could give my opinion on what I think he said, and what I think he meant was that Hakan should be nowhere near the number 10.
Well, let's wait to see what he actually said.
Can I be Zlatan? Can I be Zlatan for this
section? Okay, Ibra, che pensi you of the number 10 and Calhanoglu?
Ci dassi mango il numero 01. Guys, come on. The number doesn't mean anything anymore.
It doesn't. It's
sad to say, but the number doesn't mean anymore. You know, you give it to Hakan Çalhanoğlu, and I'm nothing against the player. I feel like he put in a great second effort. But guys, you know, if you go down the line, go on the internet and type in Milan number 10s and start from the bottom and reach to the end, right? When you have Candreva suiting up for La Nazionale with the number 10, you know that the number doesn't mean anything anymore. That was my tipping point.
Alex says, should Pioli play Benacer, Tonali, and Kessie with a 4-3-1-2? Should he change the system after the success of the end of the last system? So I know we touched base on that one there, but that could be, you know, a rotating, maybe a plan B, 4-3-1-2. But then it's like, you know, what two strikers do you put up there? But I see more, like you were saying, Steve, that kind of formation, like mid-game, just change it up a bit. You know, if let's say Ibra is getting a bit tired, you know, bring in somebody else from over there. But I don't see a problem playing all those three midfielders together.
No, I don't see a problem putting those midfields together. The thing is that, you know, again, I'm going to bring up those Brescia highlights that we see. We see a lot of Tonali on the wing, which is nice. And he is that mezzala that we need. I just don't want to see Kessie at the mezzala. He struggled in the 4-3-3. It's not his game.
Yeah.
I don't want to sacrifice Kessie right now. Not at this point.
Yes. So he had said that great players word before, and that he has to up his game, and he definitely up his game, but not to the standards that we are used to in the number 10s.
I am the Montreal Zlatan, guys. Just hashtag me, Steve Montreal Zlatan. Without even knowing what he said, I knew what he said. He's not good enough, guy. He speaks the truth, the guy. And you know what? That the Çalhanoğlu has to understand that too. It's not. He's not that DH. He's not that player. Right.
There's nowhere but up to go from here, because you can't get lower than he was at the beginning of the season.
And the second half of the season, he showed that, you know, he is able to put in some performances. But again, the knock on Hakan is we need him at the beginning of the season. We need him to start well and finish well. The consistency, because at the end of the season, everything changes. The pressure is less. You know, you're obviously in your head. You know, you're not fighting for Champions League. It's tough, guys. I'm not saying that their job is easy playing soccer professionally 365 days a year. But, guys, Hakan Çalhanoğlu has to start well. And if he does, you know, I'll give him that credit, but he'll never be my Milan number 10. The Milan will change with a true number 10.
Rossonera social mailer says, with Pirlo and Juve in experience, Conte and Inter in the state, will Champions League be easier to reach for Milan upcoming season? Because I see Juve finishing sixth. I see us finishing third. Sorry, Rossonera. Juventus sixth? No. You have too much quality on that team to even an experienced coach in there. Again, I still think, you know what I think, Steve? Maybe this year the top six teams will have more of a battle, hopefully, right? And if
it was a battle 1-2-3, 4 dropped off a little bit more this year, but yeah, I agree with you. We know one
Ibra Stevovic.
Yeah, that's a nice one, Ibra Stevovic. I agree that it's going to be more of a battle. But, guys, you have to remember, you know, the people saying Juve 6th. Guys, I hate Juve just as much as you guys hate Juve. Do I want to see them finish 6th? Fucking right. I hate Juve. Finish a little bit in the shoes of Milan. 6, 7, 8. It's going to burn. The thing is that Juve, unfortunately, have the financial power, which is fiat, that will the market didn't even open yet, guys. They're not gonna flambe Pirlo on the first try. They're gonna try to get him the players that he wants. So we'll see. I'm interested to see what Juve does in the Mercato because they have a very difficult Mercato ahead. This is gonna show what their top level is made of because they have a lot of old players on very high wages. Remind you of anybody that no one wants to pay for, but they need to get off their books.
Francis says, although this is exciting news for Milan, I just hope the boys will be able to bring everyone back down to earth. The Tonali signing is a long-term one. It does not guarantee Milan a top four finish for next season. Milanisti needs to keep this in mind, as Vinny and Steve. So he's basically saying exactly what you were talking about before. Let's keep our foot. I mean, he's saying it as an Interista because, you know, he doesn't want to sound bitter or anything like that, but... Yeah, Steve, exactly what you were saying at the beginning. Let's just keep it.
And he's bitter for the right reasons. He understands why they want to go for certain transfers like Vidal and the Kante, because Conte's mission, Conte cares about now. Yeah. Conte cares about now. He is not one to shy away from winning now, and then he's going to run. He will leave that team in shambles. He will leave if he wins and he buys the players that he wants and he does win. He will not resign again because he knows that he will not be able to win again. And he will leave that team in shambles. And that's what Interisti are scared of. That's the true Interisti, the one who can see the transfer as it is. For someone like Nima, who owns an actual Inter website, to say, my God, what the fuck is my team doing letting Sandro Tonali go for Vidal and whoever else they want to buy? Guys, you have to tip your hat to people like that. Yeah. Because they're able to see the transfer for what it is. A guy like Francis, he's pissed. He wanted that. But they have that young backbone, right? They have the Barella. They have the Sensi when he's not hurt. Seems like Brozovic is out the door as well. That's a lot of their muscle. But Inter has made some terrible mistakes. You know, they let Zaniolo go to Roma. That's, you cannot make those mistakes. Look good at the time, but Nainggolan is disco dancing in Cagliari. Disco dancing. Could you imagine Nainggolan and Vidal on the same team?
Jesus.
Bruschi is all around. Bruschi.
Fade to Black talking about the respect for Maldini and Massara, which we... you're saying, like, if we're going to have a surprise signing, we already answered that one before. Yango saying, surely people have to start respecting Maldini. And I guess Massara is still not sure what his role is. But if Milan really seal all of these deals with the reported limited budget, it's some great stuff for the two of them. So definitely a change in perspective from whether it be myself, yourself, to now, from Maldini at the beginning to now. So a lot of people are sharing the exact same thoughts as us, Steve. Because I knew, like, we had a lot of questions, but they basically resembled most of them from there. So far, Steve, Tonali, they're just waiting to be completely official. I know we're talking like this, like it's a done deal, but, you know, there's always that slight, the Ragnik whole thing, right? So we're just going to keep our fingers crossed. Everything goes down well, that we make this whole, I think, what is it, Steve? 10 million for the loan. Then next year you pay 25 plus 3 of bonus or something like that. But hopefully we should have, because obviously Pioli wants to get him to train with the rest of the squad, right? Game is in 2.5 weeks. It's not like we have lots of time on our hands.
No, we don't have lots of time on our hands, but it's an important one, right? You don't want to have that. Look, I'm saying this with some sort of confidence because the guys reporting this are guys that I like to follow a lot. And when they're actually reporting something, it's not for followers, right? It's not for clicks. It's actually they have that information. Yeah, guys, they could and can be. They could be wrong. But now, if they're wrong, then there's no use of having a mercato. We just might as well just turn off all our phones and let's go from there, right? So.
Exactly. So, sorry. So, other news at Milan, even for General Steve, we're talking to seeing Juventus is getting up there with everything they want to be signing, Inter with their signings. Roma, you're not hearing that much, right? Other than the official sale, what was it, maybe?
Roma signed Pedro.
Pedro?
From Chelsea.
From Chelsea.
From Chelsea.
Huh. How about you?
And Mandzukic is official.
Who?
Mkhitaryan from Arsenal. He's official.
Okay. God, please, guys, give us some more players that Steve cannot pronounce the names. We're just going to have so much fun next year. What was I saying? We had, was going to that. Oh, yeah. How about, Steve, these couple of, it's funny how all this excitement, once again, and we're going to bring it up once again, Steve, nobody's talking about Donnarumma here. It's a couple of articles that I see about this whole Chelsea thing. They wanted to give us Kepa.
Yeah, for sure.
Would give us Kepa, and they would take him, and something wasn't making any sense because it's like, you know, his contract finishes this year, so why would you take him and take the risk of letting him go from over there? But let's talk about Donnarumma. What do you think? Should we be worried? No.
I'm always worried.
Yeah.
I'm always worried because, you know, again, it's funny, and I'm going to repeat it for anybody who didn't hear it. I was really a Raiola hater. I really hated him. I really hated his style. But ever since that Yong Hong Lee thing, I have a newfound respect for this guy. He called our fucking bluff. He called Milan out and saying this project is complete shambles. And, you know, and we gave him a lot of shit, myself included. And from there, when he was actually right... Guys, I found a new respect for this guy. He really looks out for, of course, he wants the money. Let's be honest, that's how he gets paid. But he really looks out for where his players are going, what kind of bridge deal he can sign to make a shit ton of money, and then how can we resell him again so that he can make even more money. He did it with the Pogba. Pogba was a genius deal.
Yeah.
He's going to end up, Pogba's going to move at another time. One more time, he's going to make a ton of money. So Donnarumma, am I scared? I'm always scared. I want to know how much he's going to ask for. We have already, you know, Ibra at 7, okay, on 1 year. And, you know, we're going to need to sign Donnarumma at around that, at least. So...
we'll see.
But the difference between... when we re-signed them and now is that there's actually some sort of project that's filling up. You know, important signing, Tonelli is an important signing because it shows that we're committed to the future, but we're also committing to now. And the key for Donnarumma, guys, is Champions League. That's why that fourth spot is so important. And right. and his contract, right now, it should be something that, you know, get rid of the Mercato stuff now and try to re-sign him. That's what I say.
And Frank brings up a good point, right? If Donnarumma isn't extended by December, you got to sell him because January, February, you can start, you know, negotiating on free transfers. We can't take that chance, letting go of
we cannot. That would be an ultimate fail. Whatever we've done this transfer will be all thrown in the garbage if we lose a generational type player like Donnarumma for free.
Steve, any indigestions this week? Anything that, you know, kind of got to you, something that pissed you off? I know you were very excited with all this Mercato madness.
A little bit of indigestion, to be very honest, is when Ibra was signing and he wanted to change his number twofold. One, getting away from 21 and going to apparently 9. Well, I don't know how we apparently went to 9 and then he ended up taking back 11. But that pissed me off a bit. Like, just make a decision already and Milan social media send out the right information. And two, once we were re-signing Ibrahimovic and the people explaining him changing his number because he was opening up the 21 for Tonali. It's like, oh my God, well, please, guys, please stop it. It's honestly, it's exhausting. It's even exhausting. I stay away from Twitter in terms of writing back to those comments, not because I don't want to reply to them. It's because it's exhausting. It's exhausting repeating myself because then they'll go, oh, Steve, you're negative. You're a negative guy. You're a negative Milan fan. No, I'm a realist. I call shit when it's shit, and I call good when it's good. And sometimes it's hard to hear, but that's the way I roll, and I'm not going to change.
Well, yes, we're going to take it to the away kit, even though it's not official. But my digestion this week, dude, leave it to Lazio in a year of 2020, right, where people are battling racism and Black Lives Matter and all this stuff. Why don't we welcome, you know, Pepe Reina with like a kind of a fascist message, you know, in English, it just translated to Roman salutes to Camerata Reina, like, you know, like a comp, like it just, Lazio's never going to change, right, Steve? Those ultras, yeah. Sorry, not just excuse me to all regular Lazio fans, but those ultras, they just take it to another level.
Yeah, they just there's that threshold where unfortunately they find a way year after year to pass.
Unfortunately, feel good moment before we talk about our brioches of the week. Did you see the leaked white jersey?
Leaked white jersey, yeah, it's not. But guys, if you look, there's some really terrible other jerseys. Ours is not that bad if you start looking at the other ones, right? So
if that's the way I see fashion thing, right? I get it. They're trying to do something different. And guys, if the only thing we need to complain about in a couple of months is the away jersey, we're on a good track, right?
But imagine lifting the Scudetto with that ugly jersey. Ugh, I wouldn't be able to do it. Oh, yeah. I would ask them to change it, right, Vinny?
Exactly. Yeah, they like Photoshop me another jersey. It's not. It's different, right? I spend money on it? No,
probably not.
No,
but traditionally, I have to say, Vinny, you know, we talk about all the time. I usually would never spend my money on the away jersey. There's only one that I think I have. To be very honest with you, I like the traditional stripes. Even the third jersey. Would I buy the third jersey? Unfortunately, Facebook Frank, he knows that the jerseys don't fit us. I'm talking for me and Frank because we had this conversation, so he's not gonna get angry. But I like the traditional stripes, and I like the difference for other people who can fit into that third jersey. Right? It makes it nice, and the away jersey is something nice as well. But I don't know. I was never a big guy with
which one. And I still have it here. They gave it a throwback a couple of years back, I think, when Sharawi was still in the team. But white and the red and black stripe just across here.
Yeah,
that's the nicest one. So classic. I still have that jersey there. And G was asking if I was going to get a Tonali jersey. Now, Jimmy, if I buy jerseys, it's always with after the Balotelli one, it's always going to be
legend. A legend, so, yeah.
Van Basten, I have Seedorf, Maldini, all these guys. So no, I'm not putting any regular players on there. Brioche, Steve. Milan Twitter?
No. Brioche is finally this mercato. We're getting stuff done early in the mercato. We're making transfers that are for now and tomorrow. We're involved and we're dealing with teams like Real Madrid, who, you know, guys, let's tip our hats to Real Madrid, who've stacked themselves with all kinds of, and have the money to do so, because they're owned by the Spanish government, and have stacked themselves with so much talent. Like a guy like Diaz, who is a Spaniard as well, can get loaned out, but they have that grip, right? You know, and again, I like to see Chelsea active in the mercato. I find that when they're active in the mercato, it's like you're playing a video game. They splash $100 million on young Germans. They go throwback to Thiago Silva for the center back. It's amazing stuff, man.
I gotta go with the good feeling about knowing you're turning heads. As a team, Milan, like it's been a while that, you know, there was the Higuaín's in the past. Yes, there was the Sposcamole, Colibri, Bonucci. That was a surprise kind of thing. But this one just feels different. I think it's because of this whole project thing. And it just looks like people were taking us a bit more seriously now. So just a good feeling of a Milanista that it's. That's my really good feeling, really, let's say, from this past week, is just that I don't know how to explain it. It just seems that we're being taken more seriously than we have in the past, where a guy like the Higuaín's or the Bonucci, you know, maybe Bonucci, we didn't think he was just going to stay a year or two, but, you know, this whole, call him whatever you want to call him, the future like this, future like that, it just feels good to have a player of this caliber and potential coming to a team where he grew up watching.
And it's even it's a statement in the mercato that were able and were able to identify. Okay, it's not easy. It's not brain surgery to identify Tonali's talent, but it's a statement buy because he was pretty much done and signed with Inter, guys. You know, and the people are gonna say, "Oh, Inter lost interest in him." That's not true. I don't believe that. I believe that Inter knew that they had him signed and wanted to take advantage and sell some of the players that they need to sell before finalizing that transfer. Now, did something happen and they decided to take another route? Magically, that happened once Milan was very interested in Tonali. So I seriously doubt that. But in the end, do you blame them? They have the Barella, they have the Sensi, they have that young midfield. If their window is now and they do want to sign, I'm going to call them Senatori or older type players to win now, you have to take that. It's like in the Stanley Cup. You're going to have to give up or any team. You're going to have to give up some draft picks sometimes or some young talent to buy some old veteran players who can get you over that hump, right? And that hump right now is first being active and being someone who can compete for Scudetto, especially now that we don't know what Juve is going to come out with. And I think last year was the weakest Juve of the 9 years that they've won the Scudetto, by far the weakest. And I think next year, if they don't make any impactful signings, that will be the weakest one.
Very well said. And it's great to see for the first time, we've been 45 to 50 live viewers, guys. You guys are awesome, Facebook and YouTube. We will finish off on this note. We will talk to you guys next week. The Presidente has another special project for us. We've got to hang up here and do another test from over there. Let's hope he does it quickly, Steve, because I'm dead tired. Guys, once again, thank you to all our patrons on the Patreon page. We had a reading the news on Friday, so we're going to be announcing another monthly special soon. Maybe a discussion about the number 10 with Ibra Stevovic, who was the greatest number 10s. I know I have a nice list compiled here. Watch-alongs with this internet doesn't look like it's going to happen. If not, we're going to have to come to your house, Steve, and do that. So thank you to all, too. Thank you to all to support us. We really appreciate it. Guys, Steve, any closing words?
Yeah, go check out Italy's new Puma jersey for this year. That's a fantastic jersey. The detail is top-notch.
And they're playing when, Steve? Maybe when are they playing? Next week?
I don't know. There's just that's another thing. That's a little bit of an indigestion. With all that's going on, there's these friendlies there. I think they could have taken away a little bit of soccer, but it seems like the almighty dollar is going to win again, and we're going to play these guys down to the ground, right? So that's a little bit of my indigestion as well. I agree for once. I think... I mean, I can't believe I'm going to say this on air, but I think it was maybe Gasperini who said that. No. It wasn't Gasperini. Thank God, Vinny. I almost said something that I was going to regret for the rest of my life. It was ADL. Di Lorenzo said that the friendlies at this time is completely garbage, and he's 100% right with that. I don't think it was the time to have friendlies.
Good old ADL. Guys, thank you. David, to you, thank you very much. Frank, Faz, Casey, everybody that's seen from all over the world. We appreciated a couple of comments last week, again, from Kuwait. It looks like we have a couple of people from Kuwait, Steve. Not only two patrons, but a couple of people from over there. Singapore, a comment from there. It's just a fantastic feeling, and here we are, just two regular schmoes and just talking Milan. That's what we're all about, guys. On that note, ovunque e sempre.
Youssef says Forza Milan.
Ciao, guys.